Hello, my name is Jason Johnson, and thank you for watching this video. I hope that all my videos are helpful for you, and thank you for subscribing to my channel. If you have any questions or feedback for me, you can leave a comment below, and I'll try to get back with you as quick as possible or point you in the right direction with feedback. So this video covers Chapter 2, Introduction to Lab Procedures and Tool Use for the Cisco NETACAD IT Essentials course. So let's get started here. So we're going to talk about two different main areas. We're going to talk about in this first section is safe lab procedures, and then we're going to talk about proper use of tools. So with safe lab procedures, what we want to look at first is protecting people. So we want to talk about protecting people, and then we're going to talk about protecting equipment. In the area of protecting people, we want to make sure that we have a look at general safety first, and you want to make sure that you have a first aid kit available. Make sure that you know what's in the first aid kit. Make sure that you're prepared to use it, that you know that the different thing, you know, from anything from a Band-Aid to a bandage. I would recommend getting with, in the United States, you can get with your local Red Cross and take first aid courses, or get with the local hospital and take first aid courses and take some basic first aid, just so you know how to, you know, how do you treat cuts? How do you treat a burn? How do you treat, things like that? And whether, somebody gets a burn, somebody gets a cut, something along those, if somebody trips and falls, how do you handle that? You want to make sure that if you have any unsecured cables, that they are moved out of the way, or that they're taped down, or that they are secured so that they don't create a tripping hazard. With food and drinks, the best thing to do is just not bring any type of food and drink into your workspace. When you're working with electrical devices, that includes water. That includes, don't bring your Doritos and your Mountain Dew into your workspace. Leave those somewhere else. You don't need those when you're working. And again, that includes water, because water can spill into an electrical device and harm it, or electrocute you as well. You want to make sure that you remove jewelry. If you have rings on, if you have necklaces on, you want to secure loose clothing. If you've got a jacket on, take it off. If you've got a tie, take your tie off or tuck it in. If you've got long sleeves, roll your sleeves up to make sure that clothing does not get caught in some type of or some of the equipment. Now, what we want to look at with electrical safety, computer power supplies are dangerous when they're disassembled, so you want to make sure that you're properly trained before you open up any type of computer power supply. If you're not trained in how to do it, don't open them up. Those, in a lot of cases, are just they are replaced as a single unit, but unless you have proper training, don't open up those power supplies. It's just not worth getting electrocuted over. And even after you've unplugged the computer, the power supply can hold electricity before it dissipates. It can hold it for a little bit of time. With working with printers, you want to make sure that with laser printers, there's areas that are hot. You want to make sure that you've turned them off. You want to make sure that you've given it a proper amount of time to cool down. So if you're going to be working with a laser printer and you know you've got to be working with a hot area, you want to unplug that and let that set for a few hours, or maybe 30 minutes or 45 minutes until that heat is dissipated. And the same thing with voltage, you want to make sure that it's unplugged. Don't leave that, don't service anything that's plugged in. It's just not worth it. And you want to check the voltage output of AC adapters. Don't interchange AC adapters, especially with like laptops or other devices, without verifying first that it's the proper voltage and the proper proper power going into that, because you can damage those devices. Now, with fire safety, we talked about electrical safety. Let's talk about fire safety. With fire safety, I would recommend getting with your local fire department. In the United States, I have had fire departments come in, and they do, in most cases, they will do free training. It's just part of the service they provide. You contact them, you schedule, they'll come in, they'll survey your area, and they'll let you know, hey, you might need to put fire escape or fire exit signs up in certain areas. They might tell you that you don't have enough space for an exit. You might only have a foot, 1 or 2 feet, and you might need to widen that to 3 feet. They're going to give you those types of tips and things like that. So when you're working with devices, you want to make sure that the power is turned off and that you unplug equipment before servicing them. That's always the rule. If you're going to use, or if you have fire extinguishers in place, make sure that you know how to use it. and make sure that you have the proper fire extinguisher for the proper type of fires. There are different types of fires. You have paper, wood, plastic. You can have solvent fires or chemical fires. You can have electrical fires, and or you can have combustible metals. So depending upon the type of fire, you want to make sure that you have the proper fire extinguisher for that's rated for that type of fire. And then make sure that you know how to use it. The acronym is PASS, P-A-S-S, pull the pin, aim at the base, squeeze the lever, and sweep the nozzle from side to side. So, you know, pull, aim, squeeze, and aim at the base of the fire, squeeze the lever, and then sweep the nozzle from side to side. Now, the next topic we're going to talk about is ESD and EMI. ESD is electrostatic discharge, and that is what builds up in our bodies when we move across, when we move, we build up electrostatic discharge. Let me say it again, electrostatic discharge, or ESD. It exists on the surface, which comes into contact with each other, differently charged surfaces. So if you walk across a room and there's a low humidity and you go to touch a doorknob and you get a zap, that is an ESD. It can cause damage to a computer equipment. And for example, if the discharge causes pain to a human, most humans, if the charge is about 10,000 volts, you'll feel that. But it only takes about 30 volts of static electricity to damage equipment. So you just want to be very careful with that. And the what we do with that is you want to make sure that you have electric or ESD, or that you have wrist straps, that you're using those, that you're using anti-static bags, you're using grounding mats on workbenches, that you ground floor mats in the work areas, and that you have anti-static wrist straps when working on computers. You just always want to make sure that you have those steps. So the other type is EMI, or electromagnetic interference, and EMI distorts the signal. It degrades computer communication. It can be generated by large motors, power lines, or other sources of electromagnetic energy. And then another area is RFI, or radio frequency interference, and that can affect wireless networks, and that can be caused by radio transmitters transmitting in the same frequency. Also, you have environmental temperature and humidity levels can affect that. So if your humidity is too high or too low, or if your temperature is too high or too low, in most cases too high of a temperature, you usually can't get it too cold unless you're out in a cold environment, you know, sub-zero temperatures. But if you get your temperatures up in the 80-degree range in a room, those electrical devices are heating at a higher temperature, and you can cause some damage to them. So you want to make sure that you have proper ventilation and proper humidity controls in your environment. Now, with power fluctuations, or when we provide power to electrical devices, and all devices need power, we have different types of power fluctuations. And a blackout, when we have a blackout, that's when you lose complete loss of AC power. You've lost everything. That can be caused by a down power line or a blown fuse or something like that. A brownout is reduced voltage. Then it usually lasts for some period of time. Brownouts occur when the power line voltage drops below 80%. You don't have a complete loss of power, but you have less than 80% of normal voltage, and that can cause electrical or cause problems with electrical circuits. And you can have electrical noise. Noise is interference from generators or lightning. It produces poor quality power, and it can cause errors in the computer and in your electrical devices. A spike, when we have an electrical spike, that's a sudden increase in voltage. It usually lasts just a short amount of time, but they can be caused by lightning strikes. They can also occur when electrical system comes back on after a blackout, and you'll get a spike of electricity. And then you have a power surge. And power surges are, they are voltage above the normal flow of electrical current. A power surge usually lasts for just a few nanoseconds, or, you know, micros of seconds, or a billionth of a second. And to protect those, we put power protection devices in place. And when we do that, we have UPSs, we have SPSs, a UPS, or we have surge protectors. That's the first level. Surge suppressors help protect against damage from surges and spikes. Surge suppressor diverts extra electrical voltage that is on the line, and it grounds it and sends it to the ground. A UPS, or uninterruptible power supply, helps protect against potential electrical power problems by supplying a consistent level of electrical power. to a computer or device. The battery is constantly recharging while the UPS is in use. So if you get a brownout, it's going to provide the extra power. If you have a blackout, it's going to provide full power until the battery runs out. And usually in those cases, you have some type of system set in place to be able to turn the equipment off before you lose battery power. And many UPS devices can communicate directly with the computer to do that. So if you lose full power, the UPS will send a signal to the computer to shut down or the server. You also have what we call standby power supplies, and those help protect against potential electrical power problems by providing a backup battery to supply power when the incoming voltage drops below a normal level. And the battery is on standby. In some cases, you can have you might have a generator as a backup as well. I've worked in places where and their main operations center had a diesel engine out of an old Navy ship. And they could start. They could fire up the diesel, that old diesel engine, and then provide power to the facility. So there's a caution though on UPSs. UPS manufacturers suggest that you never plug a laser printer into a UPS because the printer can overload the UPS. So that you know you want to have a note of caution about that. Now with other procedures that we're going to look at here. We're going to talk about procedures to protect the environment and protect you in general as well. We have safety data sheets or SDSs. Safety data sheets used to be known as MSDSs. The federal government maintained those, and in some cases, state governments maintain those. But usually, OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, which is a subdivision of the United States Department of Labor, they will maintain SDSs on all different types of material. And what those sheets will do for you is they will have information about different types of material, including procedures for the proper disposal. And you want to make sure that you have those SDSs on file, and whether it's electronic or printed out, and you want to make sure that you understand how to handle that material and how to dispose of it. So for example, if you have some cleaning solvents, you want to make sure that you just don't dump those down the drain. That you have a proper procedure for getting rid of those. The SDS is going to contain information on the composition, how it affects your personal health, fire hazard, and first aid requirements, which is important. So let's say that you get some toner in your eye. You know, you get laser toner in your eye. How do you deal with that? Do you flush your eye? Do you need to not flush your eye and get to the emergency room? You know, what is the procedure for that? And the SDS is going to contain information on how to do that. It also has information on the safe handling and storage of materials, about spills, leaks, and disposal. And when we're talking about disposal, whether you're disposing of material such as laser toner or some type of chemical, you also, when you dispose of equipment, you want to make sure that you're disposing of that properly. Whether it's batteries or monitors or toner kits or cartridges, you want to make sure that you're disposing of those properly. I know where I live in particular, it is a local, you know, it's a crime to dispose of monitors, especially the old CRT monitors, into the waste disposal. You can't just put a monitor in the trash can. You can get a fine for that. And so what you want to do is you want to find somebody that's going to recycle those electrical components for you. We do a battery recycling program where I work, and we take those batteries and we take them to the it's a company called Interstate Batteries, and they recycle those batteries for us for no charge. We just take them in 5-gallon buckets. They take them and dispose, and they properly dispose of them, or they recycle them. With the monitors, I take them to my local Goodwill. It's a company called, you know, if you're in the United States, you know what a Goodwill is. And I take my old monitors and old equipment there, and they will take those and recycle those for us for no charge. And in some cases, they'll come to your facility and pick those up for you. So you just want to make sure that you're doing proper equipment disposal. Okay, so next we're going to talk about proper use of tools. We're going to switch gears, and we're going to talk about the second part of the video here, and that's proper use of tools. So you have tools running all the way from ESD tools. You always want to make sure you have a good anti-static wrist strap and mats in your work area, that you're using those and properly using those. Whether you're using the right hand tools, screwdrivers, flashlight, pliers, make sure that you don't have tools that are magnetic tipped. Magnets and electrical components do not work well together, especially hard drives, especially the old magnetic hard drives. Make sure that you're using the right cable tools. This is an example of a toolkit that you can purchase, and it has all the different various types of tools. What I would say is, if you're just starting out into the computer repair area or working in this, you're going to put your toolkits together and you're going to find over time what works best for you. I have a larger toolkit, and I just have, based on what type of work I do, I have different types of tools in there. It doesn't include everything that may be in here. I don't necessarily do any type of soldering for the most case. I've got a soldering iron, but I don't keep it in my toolkit because I don't do it that often. Crimpers and things like that are in there. And then smaller types of screwdrivers, bits that work with my different types of drivers and things like that. And then other type of diagnostic tools, whether it's a multimeter, whether it's a loopback adapter or a Wi-Fi analyzer, things like that, or maybe even external hard drive enclosure so that I can take an external hard drive and pull information from it. Might be involved. Now, on the other side, we have software tools, and those are going to be specific to the operating system, but we use those to diagnose problems, maintain hardware, and protect the data stored on a computer. They can include anything from disk management to drive optimization to disk cleanup, and they're going to be different depending upon your operating system, whether it's a Windows or a Linux or an Apple. They're going to be a little bit different on which ones you have. And as you work over time, you're going to figure out which ones work best for you. And in the, if you take the Cisco NETACAD course, which you probably are if you're watching this video, the course material is going to give you more information on which tools work best in which situation. Now, with organizational tools, we have in any organization, even whether it's small or large organizations are usually going to be more organized with this. Large organizations are going to have more organization, obviously, but they're going to have more referencing. But it's important that a technician document all your services, that you document everything for future reference. You want to have personal reference tools that you use. I recommend getting some type of a journal and keeping notes in it, you know, a physical journal, and that you write in that things that happen all the time, or maybe websites that you go to, things like that. Yes, we have digital devices that you can keep that information on, but if you can't get to your digital device or something goes down or you lose a hard drive and you're in a crunch time or you have a short amount of time, it's always good to have a physical reference manual to go back to reference. And then if you have any reference guides, things like that, repair journals, what I always did when I was working in a server administration, I printed out some basic information about each server and kept a notebook, a binder, close to that server. And so it had information about the type of operating system, the type of memory, the type of hard drives, when it was last patched. Information like that was printed out so that if I couldn't get to it, I had that readily available in a printed out copy. The internet is great for referencing information. But at the same time, you want to make sure that you have it easily accessible. And the last note on that is you want to make sure that you have ways to reference information, whether it's different websites on the internet that you're going to. There's depending upon what you're doing and which area. I know I've worked in areas where a specific type of database that we were using for a paint manufacturing company, and they used a particular type of database and a particular type of software. And so there was help support groups online of all the different companies and all the technicians and database administrators that use that software. And we would get online, and it was like a, you know, we called them bulletin board systems back in the day, but news groups or chat rooms or, you know, information where we could post information about what was happening. And we would come together collectively to say, okay, I'm having this problem with the software. How did you solve that? You want to make sure that if you have those types of references that you know how to access those and where to find those. Okay, so we have talked about safe lab procedures. We have talked about correct tool usage, how to work in a safe manner to protect users and equipment, following safety guidelines to help prevent injuries, how to protect equipment from ESD and EMI and the different types of electricity discharges and electromagnetic interference, how to prevent power issues, using a proper UPS, making sure that you have enough battery backup time for computers. Know which products and supplies require special disposal procedures. You need to familiarize yourself with SDS, with the safety data sheets for proper safety and disposal restrictions. And you want to make sure that you use the correct tool for the correct task. Don't use a screwdriver or don't use a hammer when it requires a screwdriver, and don't use a screwdriver when you can use a pair of pliers. Make sure that you know how to clean components safely and properly with the proper chemicals and proper cleaning materials. And then make sure that you're using organizational tools during computer repairs document what you're doing, and research and reference materials for that. Okay, so this is the end of chapter two for the NETACAD IT Essentials. If you have any questions or comments, I welcome any feedback that you have for me. Just leave those in the comments below, and I do appreciate that, and I hope you have a great day.